last part is recorded. Okay,
oh, I'll stop recording now.
Oh.
Okay. So I mostly work with the CommOps team, and I work on metrics related stuff. So, like, these are all the links. That's my TAS ID. That's the web page. You can check it out and connect with me on Twitter, LinkedIn, whatever. So, so till now, for metrics, I've worked on analyzing Fedora data, Fed message data, basically, to understand how people interact in IRC, or how like events like this conference or like force them impact your contribution activity and so on. So it's some pretty exciting stuff. So this talk, will be about improving the contributor retention rate. So we have a lot of like newcomers coming to Fedora, like they join FAS groups, they ask in IRC like what should we do now and so on. But I mean, not many of those get retained, like they don't become long-term contributors, they just drop off somewhere in between. So we want to look at like improving those contribution, like contributor retention rates, and like what we can do that. So since I work with metrics, I'll be looking at it from some sort of data perspective. And so for that, I did some sort of survey also. So we'll look at the results of that survey. And I also analyzed Fed message data of some, you could say, pretty successful and long-term contributors. So I was hoping we could look at that. And then we could, in the end, we could have an open discussion about some important things. I mean, some important topics which came from the survey too, or if any questions you have or anything. Yeah. So these basically are the number of FAS accounts that were created. So in 2012, it's pretty low because that's when the Fed message thing started, and I gather all the data from Fed. So. Yeah, so you could see that roughly every year 5,000 new FAS accounts are created, but not all of these are for people who want to contribute to Fedora actually. So some people, I think, just create the FAS account for posting questions in Ask Fedora or something. I mean, so yeah, so I basically tried to divide them into number of like contributors we were looking at by their activity. So if the messages are not just about FAS account creation, then I basically classified them as contributors. So this is like the year-wise distribution for like short-term contributors, long-term contributors, and those who are inactive. So as you can probably see here, like we have a lot of you could say orange thing, which is like short-term contributors. So short-term contributors are basically those which came, they did some activity, like they contributed a little to Fedora, and then they left after 3 months. Long-term ones are those who stayed after 3 months. And inactive ones are just the ones who are not like, who just created the accounts and were not interested in contributing. Yeah?
So does inactive in 2016 mean they've done nothing in calendar year 2016, or that's an account?
Yeah, so yeah, that's actually interesting, because we had a lot of spammers in this year, so that's why.
I have a list of the spam accounts that I can give you.
Okay, so that's why we have a lot of inactive contributors there. But yeah, so I think we can probably look at these things and probably the ratio between
how exactly is inactive measured in this, like not a single interaction?
Yeah, so it's basically like they have less than 10 Fed message count, and they are mostly for FAS, like so in Fed message we have topics for FAS, right? So like FAS some create ID or update ID. So If they are just those fast messages, then it's like inactive. And then there's another thing that, so we also looked at the not category for Fedora badges. So basically this is how I measured it. So those, the inactive ones are not really contributing at all. They're just creating a FAS account and updating it. They didn't, I mean, contribute to anything else. I mean, or if they did, it was not in one of the Fed message topics. But I think we have a pretty comprehensive list on Fed message. So if, even if they attended at least one IRC meeting, it would be recorded in Fed message.
What about mailman?
What?
Mailman.
Yeah, even that's their mailman is there. And short-term ones are those who like contributed for less than 3 months, and long-term ones are those who have like 3+ months activity. And even those who like contributed and then went away for a considerable period of time and then came back and joined and again contributed. So if they stayed for a long time, I considered them in long-term. So for like 3+ months, that's the criteria there. So what we can see is basically from this graph that even though like 5,000 something, like about 5,000 accounts are created, and only 20% of them become long-term users. So the purple ones are the long-term things, and only you can probably see like the every time it's something about 1,000 in these years. I'm not considering 2016 because we are still in 2016. So you can probably see that it's something over 20-30%. So it's a good ratio that 1 in 5, like out of 5 newcomers who join us, like 1 stays and becomes a long-term contributor. That's pretty good for our community. But what's really interesting is that these orange people, there's a lot of them, and they only contribute for 3 months and then they leave. So that's about 50% of the people who join, which is quite a lot. So I was trying to reduce these numbers of people who basically leave in 3 months because they're interested in contributing, right? So why are they leaving?
So what are the steps or initiatives have you taken in that direction? Do we have the data of their FAS or their mail ID, or can we contact them and ask for the reason or something like that?
Yeah, so contacting them, I don't know if they would like when people contact them,
so
like mailing them.
Out of 5, even if one contributes, so out of 5, even if one reply back.
No, out of 5, one is already staying and becoming a long term.
Asking if we just question 5 people who are leaving, and even if one of them would reply back, the valid reason or the reason or whatever reason is. So will that be helpful for us? Can we look up to something like this, or are we taking some other steps to, you know, get the reasons or retain them back?
So I haven't actually looked at what we are already doing in retaining them, like are we, but I don't think like we are mailing them something like that. So most people would consider it something like spamming, like why is Fedora constantly messaging me that come and join us. So we wouldn't want them to feel like that. But I looked at some measures, like why are they leaving and what we could do to improve those things. So that's further in my talk. Yeah. So, you can find the actual numbers here. I have added the link. And yeah, 2016 was a lot about spammers. So I did a survey of some Fedora contributors to understand like what made them stay here and contribute for a long time. So I'm pretty sure like some of you have received my message about it, like do fill the survey, it's for my talk tomorrow and all that. So anyway, about 16 people took part in the survey, and they were pretty distributed. I mean, some of them are part of Red Hat now, but none of them were Red Hat employees when they began. And yeah, so they contribute to diverse areas like infra, CommOps, or diversity, apps, docs, security, everything. So I think it was a diverse group of people in general, and they all joined with the intention of contributing for a long time. So that's pretty much the kind of people we are aiming at, right? So yeah, and so these are the people who took the survey, and that's the length of contribution till now. So as you can see, like the blue thing is just like two people, I think, who stayed for so they have contributed currently for only less than 3 months, so they are newcomers. And the rest of it's like they are pretty equally distributed. So in, during the survey, we had people who had contributed from 3 months to 1 year, 1 year to 3 years, and who have been contributing for more than 3 years now. Yeah. So to look at what I saw, so I basically asked them questions about the community. So I asked them, like, what makes you contribute to Fedora? Is it the work you do, which you love, or is it the community, or is it a mixture of both, or is there something else, which I'm not looking at, I don't know. So most of them said that it was a combination of work and community, which made it made them stay. And yeah, so, and then like the blue thing is people who said that it was just the community which they loved, and that's why they stayed here for a long time. So yeah, so as you can see, that the a positive environment and a good community really matters. So yeah, and these are some like some people also feel the others option, and they talked about like the four Fedora foundations: freedom, future, friends first. And that's a sense of giving back and constant learning as the reasons which made them stay. But it was mostly like a mixture of work and community which made them stay. And then I also asked them to give ratings to how much, like, how good is the Fedora community, I mean, how much they like it. So as you can see, like, most of them have rated 5 basically is excellent, and 1 is like pretty bad, we don't like the community at all. So as you can see, like, most of them have rated 4 or 5. So it seems like everybody likes the community. It's a good positive environment. There's 1-3, and I have included it in feedback. So it's a good community in general. So why are people not staying, right? They should stay. Yeah. And this is the feedback which I got, I mean, apart from the ratings. So yeah, so the ratings give a general positive overview, but these are some points which I think we should consider. So and I think we should discuss this in the end, in the open discussion, because I mean, there are some interesting points here. Like in the first one, this is like some individuals are working a lot more than others, so we could probably discuss about steps we should take to make it a more like homogeneous distribution of work in Fedora teams. And then the second thing which I think is really important is that how should we scale the community at this moment to other countries which don't have much of a Fedora community or a small Fedora community. I think this would be a pretty good topic for discussion in the end. And the third thing which I really like, so it was here the connections are made which are not just virtual and which actually feel like real connections, because when we work in IRC, we don't actually see the other person, right? I mean, unless you're working in Red Hat and you're actually meeting other people, it's just all virtual for us. So it feels like real connections, and that's why people are actually staying. So I talk about this a bit later also, but when I talk about how like Fedora events like this conference or FedCon like affect us and impact our activity. So I think this is important. We'll look into this later. Yeah. So like you were saying, like what measures should we take? What did I look at? So So these are the three main things which I found. So I generally found it newcomers like who speak up more in IRC meetings or on mailing lists, they tend to stay for a longer duration of time than like the others who are silent. So maybe we could encourage like people to speak up more in meetings because that's a good way to interact, right, and get opinions. And one thing which we could do was we could probably assign action items to them during the meeting, some small sort of stuff like initial which you think like a newcomer could do that would probably give them a sense of responsibility early on and then like make them actually feel a part of the whole team, like they're actually contributing to the whole development process and make them stay. So the other thing which I would like to talk about is like a good feedback process. So sometimes it's just like you keep on contributing, you don't know what you are doing wrong, and you try to contact people and then like get more work, but you never really know where you are going wrong or if you are doing something wrong, what's really happening around, right? So I think a good feedback process is really important. I mean, newcomers don't actually contribute, I think, on huge, like the most important part of the whole thing. I mean, they start small, right? But still, even when they start small, giving feedback to them is really important. And we have like good mechanisms, like IRC Karma, so which we could use, and Fedora badges. So we could encourage them more to collect badges. Right? So, from my experience, what I found good in the CommOps thing was, like, when I joined CommOps, we had this sort of onboarding badge series. It was not really defined much back then. I mean, I joined about a year ago. So, but to get started, like, I had to collect some badges, and that gave me some sense of like, yeah, I was actually doing something and not really contributing, but you could say like, yes, I was going ahead step by step. Like, it was a good start for me and it kept me motivated. It helped me keep track of all the things. So, yeah, I think that badges and like giving karma in IRC would be a good way for newcomers like to give them positive feedback in the whole thing. So another thing which I would like to talk about is interns. So we have a lot of intern programs here. I mean, there are Red Hat interns, then Fedora also participates in Outreachy and Google Summer of Code, GSOC. So Justin here is a GSOC, I think, participant right now. And so these are some of the, Outreachy and GSOC are not really intern programs, but students contribute to it over the summer. So basically why I'm talking about interns is that they get a good like foothold in contributing early on because they have assigned mentors and then they contribute for a long time. So they actually work with the project, right? A lot. So we should probably make them stay because there are a lot of good examples, strong examples who started early on as Red Hat interns and then they went to become on as long-term contributors. I personally know Mary Norden is one of them. She started as an Outreachy, I think, participant, and then she is now working full on Fedora design badges and she's doing some really great work. Yeah. Another thing which I would like to talk about is that is the onboarding process. So usually when newcomers join, they don't really know, like, what should I do? How should I start? So they keep posting these questions on IRC. And yeah, people try to reply to them as much as possible. But I mean, it's a bit tough, right? Maybe you'll start and initially tell them that, yeah, you should do this. And then, but you cannot like mentor them step by step every time. And you cannot do that to every person who wants to contribute, right? It becomes a bit tough when you are working. So maybe, perhaps, having a defined onboarding process for your team like would be a great thing. So at CommOps, we are trying to create a defined onboarding process for different teams. So we have one already for CommOps. And then I think we have we are working on the modularity one and infra one already. Yeah. So it basically involves like wiki gardening tasks and getting some badges and all that for CommOps. But then it could be catered for your team. I mean, according to the team's needs and what the initial tasks would be for the team.
If you contribute to Fedora, you should come to the CommOps workshop on Thursday and help give us feedback about onboarding process for all your different subtopics in Fedora.
We have a ticket regarding the onboarding series, which you can see, and definitely add your team to it and what you want to it. So yeah, this is just a screenshot. Justin created the ticket, that's why he's in there. So the CommOps onboarding process is something like this. So you create an account and then you join the IRC, and then there's a list of badges which you have to collect. They are just basic stuff like updating in your info in IRC or speaking up in a meeting or something like that, which, or wiki gardening, which people can really do, and newcomers can do it easily. And then you could probably write a post for Com blog, community blog, and publish it. So that would be a good onboarding thing. And then design team also has one. So it got cut in the in here, but there were details about this, about design team or onboarding process too. So you can just basically see the ticket. I have added it in the, I have added the link if you want to know. And yeah, so these are some of the badges we are working on. And we are also trying to create a general onboarding type of series for everyone. So it's a badge for like posting to mailing lists and becoming more interactive and more active on them. Then there's also one for Fedora repositories and so on. So yeah, so that was one part of it. Now this is the second part where I looked at the activity of some pretty good Fedora contributors. Like, they have been contributing for a long time and they work, they contribute a lot. So I looked at about 10 or 20 of those, so I haven't included all of the graphs in here. So these are basically the data gripper charts. So what I noticed was, one of the important patterns was that so there was more consistency in the, I mean, activity rather than like contribution. So here the scale is a bit different. So this is not exactly zero in here. It's something like 100 or 200 or 1K, and it's not zero here. So I mean, you cannot see, but on data grapple charts, but so there is some activity here. This just means that this is the lowest point in here. So you can see that, I mean, it's pretty random, right? The people are contributing more sometime and they're contributing less sometime, but it never becomes zero for a long period of time. So, I mean, they are consistent, even if they are not contributing like the most always. So that's something I think we should encourage, like to in newcomers, that they stay for a long period. I mean, for a long period they contribute, like even though they are contributing not much, just a little, like doing some small stuff. But I think, yeah, that's something we should look at, like consistency should be valued more than just contributing a lot when they join. Yeah, so this is what I was talking about earlier. So, like, I measured the impact of attending Fedora events. So, I measured the impact of attending FOSDEM basically, and not Flock. So, what I was trying to do was trying to measure like how many newcomers were onboarded during FOSDEM and like how like attending FOSDEM affected the activity of Fedora contributors. Like, did their activity increase or did it decrease or what happened? So, yeah, so I have published like a blog post about it on my blog here, so that's the link. But so I had some pretty good findings. So I mean, obviously apart from newcomer onboarding that you can do at such events, and there are many people coming, and like at FOSDEM, like there are various booths, so people come and join Fedora and say they are interested to contribute. So I mean, you obviously onboard newcomers, but apart from that, I mean, if you are an existing like at contributor, so I saw a jump in like long-term activities of contributors over a period of time, I mean if they attended Fedora events like this. What happened? Yeah, so this was basically for FOSDEM 2014. So I analyzed the short-term and long-term activity. Short-term was basically just like a month before the event and then a month after the event. So there was, there were some jumps in the short-term activity too, but you could say that that was because of, I mean, they didn't work during FOSDEM or anything else. But I think the long-term activity one is pretty important. So these are basically the buckets. These are like friend message count for the users, and this is like the number of users who were contributing in that bucket, in that region. So the blue ones are before FOSDEM and the orange ones are after FOSDEM, what happened to them. So as you can see, like so here, like, so people from, I mean, there's a decrease in the number of users here, right? So people are basically jumping. So all these people, I mean, it's same here, but there are some people who jumped from there to here. So people could have jumped from this to this, but are you trying to, like, are you understanding what I'm saying? So, yeah.
So how are you able to track from FOSDEM 2014 specifically? What was the tool you used to?
So I used the FOSDEM batch. So I got usernames from the FOSDEM batch. And then I tracked their activity before, Fed message activity.
So everybody make sure to get the badge for this conference.
Yeah. Yeah.
Would your data allow you to show, for example, where the missing less than 100 people actually landed? Because, I mean, I understand the conclusion you're drawing, which is that everybody leaked buckets and we leveled out and then pushed a bunch of people over the limit.
Yeah.
The last one. But I'm kind of curious if that's what happened or if that's just our conclusion.
So you want to know whether
right,
they jumped from
here
to here.
Right, but you know who these people are. So you can theoretically tell me, you know, Bob was in the less than 100 bucket before, and by the end of your period afterward, he was in the less than 5,000 bucket.
Yeah, So I have a list of those users who jump from say bucket 1 to bucket 2 or from bucket 3 to bucket 1 and so on. But I haven't published it in the blog post, but in the blog post I have like quantified the numbers like for people who jump from
that was one of the quantities.
So it's all there in the blog post. Okay. It's quite big. So yeah, basically a lot of people like increase their activity. They jump from here to here. And that's what happened in FOSDEM like 2015 too. So yeah, if you attend a Fedora event, it impacts your activity. I don't know how or why, but it does. So you should attend as many events as possible, probably. Yeah, so that was the last thing. Yeah. So this is the last slide. This is the summary. So we found that like community matters, like positive environment matters for you to stay. So you should probably, we have a good positive environment going on in Fedora, so we should try to maintain that. Then having a defined onboarding series thing would be good. I mean, it would lessen the work for everybody, I think, when newcomers join. So it would probably help, it would be easier for newcomers to, start working with the team too, and also for people, also for team members, they don't have to interact with like every newcomer always like keeping a track of their progress probably. So this could be like a defined thing, and then we should probably encourage interactions and create a good like feedback mechanism which we can help them with, so that they probably get a sense of like their contribution, like what they are doing and how they are doing it and how they can improve. And individually, we could say that attending Fedora events is good for your activity, and you should engage more in mailing lists and IRC in meetings. Like you should encourage newcomers also to engage more, and that we should look for consistency more than just like having peaks in activity. So this is it. Questions? And yeah, a big thanks to Sachin, who helped me with metrics in some places, and he helped me a lot with the onboarding thing, because so he's basically a GSOC participant who's working on metrics and onboarding in CommOps. So questions, discussion?
I will have this evening a similar session focused only on the sponsoring part, so when people get sponsored, I come to some similar conclusions, some interesting findings that we very likely get people and who remain direct contributors from some places where community already exists, like Red Hat internal, other companies which use Fedoras or Red Hat, or universities where there is already somebody from Fedora community, because they very likely get the support from them, and they get explained when they need something about the Fedora, how it works. I'm very afraid that this doesn't work for people who are really newbies, and for example, they are along in the town, state, whatever, and doesn't have this help. And if you create a fast account, and now I will focus only on those packages. We have contributors, wikis, etc. Packages. And you will submit package review, which can take days, weeks, but even years.
Oh.
And you are suddenly alone. You don't know what to do because there is a lot of materials. They say, you can study the packaging guidelines and you can edit the wikis, but the packages guidelines, so long that even after 10 years, I don't know how, I don't have those information in my mind right now. And you try to edit wikis, and okay, so I'm now reading the Fedora guidelines, I will try to edit that, but I will find that it's locked document. The same for the front page, so what I can do, so maybe can do something better for them and actively reach them, those users, like send them emails, okay, you are now already sponsored and you built your first package in Rohide, so you now may learn about Godhead. And here is a link for the wiki, or probably some video that you will do. Or now we have the branching period. What that means? Congratulations! This is your first branching period.
Like the onboarding series. Like if we could have a defined process for the package maintainers, it would be really good. I mean, like Amita was talking about earlier about sending mails to people who are not active anymore. So I don't think it would work in all cases, but it would surely work in this case where, like you say, they have to wait for a long period of time before a review or anything like happens. So yeah, that's actually a good thing. Like if you send them mails and I think like publish a defined guideline for what they could do later on, it would actually be a good thing. So I think we could, I mean, at CommOps we could look into this. I mean, after the onboarding series, after we are done with that for the teams, we could also look, I mean, for package maintainers.
First of all, a big thanks for everything you have said and everything you have done. There's a lot of value in all that, and everything that the CommOps team does. But I'm a bit afraid that we are trying to solve a social problem with technical solutions. It's like solutionism. I mean, of course, we could just have that message listening to all the users' activities and could automate this process, like look up when the user account was created, this is your first branching window, or you have done this, you have done that. We could send out all the automated messages, but in the end, what really counts is personal contact. When I joined Fedora over 10 years ago, the groups I first joined were the packagers and then the ambassadors, both groups that had the sponsoring or mentoring process in place. So that was not a coincidence. It was these groups had this mentoring, sponsoring, whatever you call it, process in place, and these are the groups that you want to join. And you have one person that you can get in touch with for every question and so on. So I think we should rather focus on the personal side of sponsoring or whatever you call it, rather than technical solutions. I think metrics and numbers and technical things are fine to give us an impression. I think the numbers are really astonishing. Like so many people dropping out of I wouldn't have guessed that. I had no idea. And we totally need to look into that, why it's like that. But the solution then, it's not a technical one, but something that has to do with humans interacting.
Yeah, so I agree with this, but I mean, sometimes it's like you need some figures to support your facts and to take a decision, like whether this thing is better or whether that thing is better. You need some figures for that, right? So I think we could use data that way, I mean, as a support system to encourage our mechanisms and to know whether, like, to get feedback, whether what we are doing is good or is it, are we doing it somewhere, like, are we going wrong someplace? And like you said regarding the sponsorship thing, I mean, I think this has been discussed quite a lot about one-on-one mentorship, but I don't think it actually, like, works in every team, because it's not just that feasible in every team, right? I mean, they're like a small number.
It certainly wouldn't work, say, in the GNOME or in the server sync, because they don't have the manpower to have dedicated mentors or so.
But for other teams, I consider it important. We have been trying to establish something like that. But on the other hand, I don't think that you can establish the same process throughout all groups.
Okay.
Like the ambassadors have a very well-defined process. It's a step-by-step pick-through wizard already. On the other hand, other groups have hardly any information.
Yeah, so I think it should be more specific to the team. But I mean, instead of like one-on-one mentorship, like a defined set of guidelines would be good, right? I mean, like for at least for the beginning, I mean, and then you could like have some mentors, like if they stay, like a group of mentors, because one-on-one mentorship might work in small teams but not in large teams. Like suppose like there are a lot of people, say infra.
The ambassadors are the biggest group in Fedora, and they have one-on-one mentorship all the time.
So you sponsor other ambassadors, right? So like one.
Yeah, right. You need to get sponsored to become an ambassador, and they have the strictest process ever. So the hurdle to join is very high, but people can jump that high because of the good mentorship.
Okay.
The ambassadors are by far the biggest group in Fedora.
So, but do you want to keep? I mean. Like, do you want that in like all teams? Would it be good to have
if
that
it works
in all
for
teams?
Them, why not?
If it works for them, well, my point was let's try to. The decision what works for them should be on the groups.
Team, yeah.
They should define the process, their process. The process for group A is different than for group B, and so on. And
okay.
CommOps should strive to support all these by providing data and so on. I'm pretty sure that's what all you are working on. But that doesn't mean that we can establish the same model everywhere.
Yeah.
Question, who joined the Fedora ambassadors? New guys or on the long term guys?
That's a difficult thing, because the perception is some people are very strict. Some sponsors are stricter than others. They want the high hurdle. Like they say, I don't accept anybody who hasn't been in a different group before. Like you have to have another group member.
Kushal has very strong opinions.
Yes, I'm going to talk to Kushal later. Local differences too. The Indian ambassadors have different guidelines than the rest of the ambassadors, just because they have so many people applying from the universities. They require them to do something before they can become an ambassador. So there are so many regional differences. There's differences between the teams, and even differences between the sponsors. One sponsor is more, or one mentor is stricter than the other. So I think there's no way to establish a common process.
Yeah, so.
But again, it's the personal contact that matters for people.
Yeah, but if you don't have that personal contact, it's really hard.
In the ambassadors, you do have,
but you are already for some time part of Fedora,
mm-hmm.
and if you are the guy who just created the Fedora account,
mm-hmm.
and I will do something in Fedora, and you suddenly within 1 week you will run. Okay, so what I should do? I should do a package review, and now I'm waiting.
So we agree that there needs to be more interaction between experienced members and less experienced members.
Yes.
I think the key is rather that as someone comes into the group, you need to know what is expected. So a group shouldn't just let things happen, but be that we get to have a one-on-one leadership, be that they have different formal processes, it should be a transparent thing. So a group should consciously decide and say, this is what we expect, this is how we think it should go, and that is a guideline for people who want to join, and it's a guideline for people who are in the group to make the behavior more consistent. I think that's what you're looking for. I mean, if you're new, you can deal with a lot of things if you know what you have to deal with. If you have to chase the information, then the barrier is a lot higher to actually become active. So I think that's what we did in cockpit. Every time someone comes in and has a question, we point them to the documents and have another question, then we have to update those documents or have a discussion with them and and see if the process doesn't work, just make changes, just make that transparent and conscious. I think that's the most important part. The process always changes and adapts. Say the group doubles in size for some reason, some people leave, then you have to change it, but do it consciously. And I think then you have the quality. And for that, you have metrics.
Yeah.
You have the personal aspects. You have, of course, the people. It's the people who are most active will define it probably the most in a meritocracy. But if you make a conscious effort to talk about that, maybe say every once in a while, say in a group, do we need to update our process? Does it still work for us? Or update it as you go, and make that transparent to someone who joins, and make that information accessible. I mean, it depends on where you join. If you're a personal, if someone goes to you recommends joining that group, and that's one thing, maybe you go to the Fedora website and say, okay, how can I contribute? And points
to the what can I do for Fedora?
Yeah, so there's, if you take those different avenues into account and make that information accessible and transparent, I think that will work for many people.
But how would you track those users, like how they joined? How would you keep a track of them? Like, why did they join? So it would have to be something like a survey, right?
Not necessarily. I mean, if it's a website, then you have the information there, the general information. But if someone talks to you on IRC, for example, you talk to them and point them to
I would suggest to use email. Because if you use website, it's just another website, and you have a bunch of them, but you can probably anticipate what they will ask during the first year. So we can not say them, okay, here is a ton of information, study all of them, but we can say, okay, it's been 3 months since you joined Fedora, and now it's probably time to learn that we have 6. What is it? Yeah, because when you start, you don't know that we have 6, that we have community operation, that we have federal infrastructure who is running. So you can say, okay, make some kind of education and prepare the plan. So now it's 1 week since you joined, you should learn about this. It's 1 month since you joined, you should learn this. It's 1 year since you joined, you should probably learn this. And now you are educated, and please join something that educate other people, transfer your knowledge.
So it has to be something, yeah.
So you mentioned that there is a after the second, third year of contributions that the majority of people leave, right?
Third month, not year.
Sorry?
After third month.
After third month.
Yeah.
So for me, that's like a disaster. If you think of it, in terms of like how somebody can join the project. Which is just another open source project, for example. After the third, if you leave the project after the third month, it's there's something very wrong with the whole process.
I wouldn't necessarily say so. Of course, I was surprised by the high number too, but maybe it can be simply explained that they had the wrong expectations. Because the info what to achieve in that particular group was not there, the way to narrow that down is you said you probably don't want a survey because then people think we are like following them or so.
Yeah,
I think that's it should be easy to generate a list of all the people who became inactive after 3 months. You could either do a survey.
You joined 3 months ago, and for 3 months we didn't see any message from you on the developer. Something bad happened, tell us.
Yes, and it should have like, you can fill out the survey and help us understand why you left. We're trying to improve our process. Or you can contact this person.
Real person.
Like, you need to have both ways. Survey alone won't help.
So maybe a single email with a survey would be good, but not like constant pestering.
Did you analyze what the people did before they left? Like if the typical user leaving only had a few wiki edits, it was probably a spammer. But if he had tried, if it turns out, oh, it's always package maintainers leaving, because they leave because their package review gets stalled, then that's certainly something we need to analyze what they have done
yeah,
before.
Yeah, so I didn't analyze it team-wise, but it would be a good topic to analyze, yeah. Which team is linked.
Okay, just let me finish my thought. So, I don't think that's a technical or communication issue. I think that's a cultural issue. There should be an element, a cultural element of the community that is broken and should be fixed. If we start agreeing that there is an issue there, after that we're also trying to understand that we might also find a solution about it. But for me personally, as I see, because I'm not 10 years in project, I'm much less than that. That's very, very, sometimes there are a few people that are very negative, which turn other people off. And that is, if the whole system of the volunteers doesn't do anything about these negative elements, that 3 months, gonna continue again and again and again. So in my opinion, and tomorrow I have a presentation about this, there is a lot of effort done on keeping, as you mentioned, your reputation of having new people joining in, and after that all this energy is lost because of the people in the project. So in my opinion it's definitely a cultural issue of the community. And it's not a general one, it's a few people that are negative, but this needs to be fixed if we want to consider the community health.
I totally agree with you. Speaking of a cultural issue, for example, let's get back to the example of the Indian ambassadors. We had a lot of people signing up just to get a fedoraproject.org email address. And they called themselves Fedora ambassadors before they even were approved because it looked good on their CV. And that's why the requirements for the Indian ambassadors have become more strict. So there's cultural differences.
Sure.
And on the other hand, I agree with the hostile or person issue. It doesn't necessarily need to be hostile, like offending or something. There's also people who just get too powerful, who just sit there on their, who control a certain group, and it's hard for newcomers to get in. And like you mentioned, the topic of action items.
Yeah.
I know that from another community, they had somebody who was just sitting there, he was controlling their group, their design group, and whenever a new contributor came up, it was like, oh no, your design is crap, I just do it myself, and yeah, that's not how you're encouraging people.
And actually, just not to be, fair, it's not only a Fedora issue, it's many other communities, especially more communities that tend to be open.
So,
I do hope that you've seen in the last couple of years a decrease in hostility and increase in civility from the mailing lists and places where we previously had sometimes a hostile environment. We've tried really hard to remind people of the code of conduct and our friendship value in a way that we hadn't been strict about before. Kind of slow to make a change, but I feel like it's been positive. I hope other people are seeing that as well.
So I think that time's like up. We are 10 minutes over, so I don't know if there's another session in here. Yeah.
Okay.
So we could discuss more about the onboarding thing, like whether we should do mentorship or anything in CommOps workshop. So
yeah,
you should definitely
attend
to have
it. You have something about sponsoring, and your talk is?
Tomorrow I attend about countries that do not have a very active community and how to grow this community.
Okay.
Thank
you.
Thank you. Very nice to meet you.
Regarding the thing which we were talking about mailing lists earlier, so Sachin was working on that tool over here, so it's like you can use it anytime.
Oh, okay.
To gather data, and you can gather data team-wise data also, and then you can gather category-wise data also.
Oh, wow.
And for a lot of people. So it's on cloud.
Okay. I will take a look. I had no idea. Thanks. This is great. And I, the stuff I from my talk this morning, the scripts that are running are on GitHub, and I'll point you at them so you can look at those too. Right now it's killing data grabber, so I need to work with it.
Yeah, so.
Can I get
a picture of you two together?
Oh, sure.
Yeah, thanks.
3, 2, 1.
So, I mean,
good, are you happy with that? All right, awesome.
Yeah. So, I tried to do it before the vlog, but it couldn't be done because these appearance ended in August. But from next year, like,
awesome.
From next conference,
yeah.
Let's use it.
Cool, thank you very much. I guess, is it lunch now? Is that?
Yeah, I think so.
Good.
Maybe I shot some pictures of you, so I'll be happy to share. Thinking. Yeah, I'm speaking.
This is good.
Yeah, I think this is one of the best I've seen.
And it's
oh.
Laughing.
Oh.
This is also speaking in
English. Uh-huh. Maybe I just share it all to
no,
you.
Yeah.
So,
on Telegram?
No, I don't think so, because Telegram is public. So.
What, you can message privately on Telegram.
Uh-huh.
Just one-on-one.
Okay, I'm new to Telegram, so I'm not familiar with the quality.
Yeah, so I'll send you a private message on Telegram, and then you can
okay,
just
but will it be full quality of the picture, or
you have the option to send a compressed version or send a full file. Uh-huh. When you drag and drop it, or when you attach it to Telegram, it'll prompt you for that.
Okay, so somebody show me how to do it.
Yeah, so
now, how to send a private message.
I'll just send you a message and then. So you actually just click on these users. So
I don't know. I'm new to this.
Yeah, so my name must be written down because I haven't seen it for a while. Yeah, so it's here. It's here. So this is here, and then you click on message.
Mm-hmm.
So this is just for me.
Oh, this is attachment.
Yeah.
So I said hi.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So
okay.
So to attach, there's the attachment. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so you can attach
this. Right, attach multiple.
Yeah,
right?
I think so.
Right, okay, it's going to work.
Yeah.
Okay,
and then send.
Now send.
Yeah. So, I got the link.
Okay, that's fine.
Yeah. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
Did you like the talk?
Yes.
I didn't stop the video thing, so it recorded everything.
Oh. Any help packing up?
Yeah.
Need to charge me.
Justin, you need to help me to stop this, I think.
Oh, what's up?